complex system of interaction and layering of processes. No? So we look at both the cultural imprint of man on the territory and the natural areas. We look at the different sections that they were throughout time were generated. We consider the cultural input, but also the natural input, the tangible heritage, you know, like monuments and so on, but also the intangible heritage, it has to do with the memory of the city, with the traditions of the people that live there. And then we try to integrate all this in different forms, you know, in a way that is not bound to a specific closed district idea, you know, but essentially it creates the links with the territory. And then, and of course, you will have a completely different view of the city. So it, essentially, it's a way to integrate in the international charters or principles or recommendations, you know, a set of ideas that have been developed in many parts of the world. Italy was certainly important, but not only Italy, but in France and in England and so on, in which you don't see the city anymore as a, you know, just a physical artifact, but you see it as a social construct, you know, as an interaction between a given society, which lives today in an area which has inherited from the past. So the ability, the complex thing to do is to understand how we have inherited this this city. It's very difficult to find cities where are inhabited by those who have built it. You know, there are maybe one or two cases in China, but normally cities are areas where people have been living for many, many centuries. So we have to inherit, we have inherited something that is not built by us, we've adapted our life to it. So try to understand this layering process is extremely important, and try to integrate in the conservation idea the living society. And that's something that, you know, it's more difficult to do, but necessary if we want to give proper value to the heritage construct, and perhaps also avoid this say slippery road where cities are seen only as the monument is important, not the rest, and something that, you know, is also the integration between the high points and the fabric of the city. We also have tried to, in a way, we have tried to redefine what historic is. And I think it's very, very important. And I think in this respect, because I'm in Bologna, I have to say Bologna was really the avant-garde, in not only defining historic city, but also in redefining historic city. In the 1960s, Bologna was the main, say, terrain of experimentation of the management processes of historic centers. They were very lucky, the Bolognese, to have here a very smart person, of course, Professor Cerellati was, of course, the leader of this process. But I would say also you had input of one of the most important planners and architectural historians of all times, which is Leonardo Benevolo, of course. And many other people that were, of course, around this. And they created, through the study of the city of Bologna, a model that became almost universal in the study of typologies and urban morphologies, and the way in which this study of the way which cities build through time becomes a tool for the management of the transformation. But even at that time, the idea of the district was predominant, and in fact in Bologna it was made easy by the fact that Bologna has, as you know, is surrounded by a system of roads which are now replacing the ancient walls. You know? It's like an octagon. So if you look at the map of Bologna, you can almost extract the ancient city, the walled city, from the rest. So in fact, the story says that Bologna was inside the walls, intramuros. You know? Nothing was done outside. All this has evolved now, and now Bologna has been the first city to change the approach to heritage. The recent master plan, I think, was adopted maybe 8 years ago, something like this, has innovated radically the idea of heritage and said heritage is not just the one that we as planners or historians define inside a certain area, but we're going to ask the people, what is heritage. So they in fact used this consultative process to understand what heritage was. It was the first example that I know of what I call bottom-up heritage definition. Instead of a top-down, I as an expert come here, talk to the mayor, and we make a line, and that's the historic heritage. This is a bottom-up. They asked the people. And of course, it's a complex process, but it took a long time. But at the end, they realized that the way the heritage had to change the definition. And heritage was much broader than just the one that was inside the walls. There were areas that people identified the heritage because they were 19th century cities, and so the immediate periphery of the historic city. They had become historicized, and so therefore became important for heritage. But also there were modern heritage. There was even, you know, public housing was defined as heritage in this I think the idea of using an interactive process of public consultation to identify what heritage is very important and it's a key to the entire concept that I'm trying to describe. And this allows perhaps also to go beyond the normal perception of the city and, you know, to understand, for instance, and integrate how all these historic layers that, you know, belong to the city. I think the Italian cities have done quite a lot on that because they have this school of archaeological and archaeological study, but this is everywhere. When I go around the world and I see things like that, for instance, this is Athens. This is Athens. They use the Olympics. That's why they have it. They used the Olympics 10 years ago to do a lot of diggings in the center of the town, and they left this. Notice this is the subway station in the center of Athens for people to see. The traces of the past to really have a direct and almost physical relationship with their past through this stratigraphy. I think archaeologists are much more used to this idea of looking at the strata or looking at the layers, and that's why I try to bring them always in. You know, archaeologists are very good for urban planning, but they are somehow secluded normally, but I really recommend, on the contrary, to bring them in, because archaeologists have perception view of the city. But also, not only vertical, but also horizontal. Now, this is, for example, again, the city of Rabat, which was inscribed in the World Heritage List, not as an Arab Medina, not like Fez, for instance, or Marrakesh, which Morocco is very rich in cities. It was actually inscribed because of the integration of different periods of development, because this was, as you know, the capital of the French protectorate, and also the French had done a lot of intervention in the 19th century and 20th century in Rabat. So this whole thing is integrated as a complex. So you find things that come from the Roman time to 1930s, essentially. You know? And it is a layered process that is clearly visible in the in the land. Then, other thing very important is to understand where the city is sitting. No city is floating in the air. Every city is built on an environment. And this environment normally disappears under the city, so we don't see it anymore. But this environment conditions the city tremendously. As we see, normally we understand that when there is a catastrophe, you know, when there is a flooding or something like that, we understand that, oh yeah, nature counts. I think it's very, come from the world of urban planners, and normally urban planners have forgotten about this aspect, or they don't see it as the geology, hydrology, and ecology of cities are fundamental. This has become part, I think, in many parts of the world, but mostly in the US, I've seen, of a new wave of environmental planning, I call it ecological urbanism, which you've heard, which is a way to look at cities as one component of a system, of an ecological system, not the only one. Not the built part is not the only one. There are many other parts. I don't know if you ever seen this fantastic study called on Manhattan, for instance. It's called Manahatta, which is the Indian name of the city. before they came, before the Europeans came. And this study has looked at New York without New York, you know, what's there. Of course, there is a forest, there are rivers, there are lakes, there are birds, there are animals, and so on. So, and then on top of it, there is, of course, a modern metropolis, but underneath, there is something else. And they try to understand this gives a completely different view of what how preserve also a city. Then, as I mentioned, of course, the topologies and morphologies are very important. You know, and this is Benevolo, and the Bologna experience was a key moment. It's a great tradition and a great, I would say, mechanisms that have been developed and studied throughout the decades on this. I think this is perhaps the most, say, day-to-day tool, kit of the architects and planners for managing this historic city. But we have also to look at other things, you know, elements that sometimes, again, because of the district approach, are not valued enough. Because if you protect the district, then you forget about the rest. But of course, the city is not just made up of pieces. There is made up of relationships, you know, visual relationships, visual axes, and so on. All these have values for the conservation. And therefore, we have to really be very, very careful. This is, for instance, one of the rare plans for landscape protection of a city, which is Kyoto. I don't think Kyoto has been really very well preserved, but they do have a plan for preserving certain visual relationship of the major landmarks of the city, so that, you know, construction are not intruding on certain axes of view, which are considered important and so on. Now, of course, all this, and I think I've said it already, cannot be done without engaging communities and citizens. If it has to be a bottom-up approach, we have to bring this participatory approach very much to the forefront and give it perhaps the most important weight in the decision-making process, which is, you know, not easy sometimes, because you know, specialists and technical people, first of all, they feel they know better, and secondly, they have all the tools. So, you know, to really sacrifice this role is something difficult. But unless you do it, you will very hardly achieve the goal of conserving this complex system of interaction that I'm describing. And give value to the places of collective memory, which is, you know, something that, you know, I think the memory is, because the city is a long-term product of time, you know, and time is made up of memory. Memory sometimes vanishes, disappears with time, and substitutions of physical and so on. And, but you know, preserving this is extremely important. I think, for instance, I value enormously this monument that was built in the center of Berlin, you know, which is, you know, Holocaust memorial, something that, you know, really, you're not in the periphery, you know, this is the very heart of the city, really, next to the Brandenburg Tor, next to the Reichstag, and so on. So it's right at the core. I don't know if you've been recently in New York, but if you haven't seen yet the Ground Zero Memorial, go see it, because it's one of the most impressive memorialization of a historical tragedy, a historical catastrophe that I have ever seen. No, it's really one of the impressive. And of course, this will remain, you know, as part of the, you know, life of the city for a long time. So, memorialization is something that we have to put in the process of planning for conservation, as any other values. As you see, I'm looking at intangible dimensions now, not only the physical, which is very important to coordinate the two of them. And in the intangible heritage, of course, there is also a nice convention on that, but I think it's something that every city has. Italian cities are very strong. I don't know if you're going to Siena. Are you going to Siena also after Florence? No, but if you go, so you realize how important this intangible heritage is. I think, and this is perhaps the last part of this whole concept of historical landscape, we also give a lot of values to economy. Everything has to be sustained by economic processes. And normally, conservators hate this idea, you know, that you have to integrate the economy in your processes, because, you know, normally economic processes are against conservations. But unless you try to find an integration, it will not be possible to find. And finally, again, another enemy, modern creativity, modern architects in the historic cities. But I think modern architecture and modern creativity can be very, very important. As again, the Reichstag in Berlin, which was, as you remember, packaged by Christo a few years ago. There are many cases. I think it's important to integrate modern creativity in the system. Otherwise, you will not have a life. You will have a monument that has deprived of life. Now, just to come to some conclusion, because I think that more or less we've seen, and I would like to bring you to the culture of the future. We're trying to bring all these ideas into the UN world. The UN world does not have heritage, and in fact, there's no culture. These are the Millennium Development Goals as defined in the year 2000. And as you see, they're very important. In fact, they are extremely important, reducing poverty, improving maternal care, achieving education. These are the key objectives of international policies. But none of them has anything to do with culture. Or perhaps, I think they have to do with culture, but it's not visible. What we're trying to do in the past 15 years is to, this is the year 2000, right? The year 2015, they issued the new sustainable development goals. So there was a long period of reflection and policy making inside the UN system in order to achieve in 2015, and this is a picture of the day of the Palace of the UN in New York, this other system, which is now made up of 17 goals instead of the original 8. Where, on the contrary, you will find that there are much more cultural dimension, especially in certain areas that have to do with education, have to do with environment, have to do with poverty alleviation, and have to do with cities. So we actually did a lot of effort, and we deployed a lot of effort for almost 10 years to try to convince our colleagues and friends of the UN that culture was an important dimension for the UN development agenda. It was essentially an economic area, and we were able to convince a lot of people around the world to start projects, UN projects linked to culture, that it was very important for development and integration of people. It was a tool for ensuring peace and security, as a way for establishing dialogue with communities, for integrating communities in different processes, including migratory processes and so on. It was an environmental tool for environmental protection. And you could actually have a lot of dimension, but the most important, I think perhaps where we were most convincing, was on cities. And that's where, in fact, today, cities and culture is mostly represented. UN development goals. There's one, which is number 11, that is creating a sustainable, inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable cities. So we, in fact, were able to insert our message in this. And then we used one opportunity, which was the Habitat 3 conference, very important conference. The Habitat conference is done by the United Nations every 20 years. A long time. So we the last one was in 2016. The next one, 2036. So it's a long way. So we used the 2016 one to, which was essentially a conference on the metropolitanization of the world. The world has become urban. Majority of the world has become urban in 2011 or 12 or something like this, and we're now at 54% urbanization. But by 2050, 70%, so it's in our world, the future is urban. That's why we have used this slogan, culture, urban future, because we think that urban is the area where culture will have bigger effects. Not that there is no culture in the rural, of course, but in the urban dimension, there will be a much bigger effect. And in this book, this report, actually, we have done two things. First of all, we looked at the situation of the world. And believe me, this was not easy, because we realized that even in the academic world, there was never a study, comprehensive study had been done on the situation of urban heritage global. It was something that really struck me since a long time. How possible? Because if you look at archaeology, you find it, you find the global
monuments, you find the global picture. If you look at cities, you don't find it. So we did it. We did the first global study on urban heritage. We took the entire world, split it up in areas and so on, and used the same model. And so the first half of this report is the global study on the different areas of the world. I think it's extremely important to understand the situation and the way in which different regions of the world perceive and preserve urban heritage. And then we try to use this material to develop our own policies. We have used these three P's, people, places and policies, to identify where culture can represent and be useful, as a tool for sustainable urban conservation and development. The first P is people-centered cities. This is, I think, very clearly from what I just narrated. It's clearly an idea. Trying to push cities to become inclusive areas. They're not easy because sometimes we are, especially now, in a moment in which there's more, divisive and seclusive approaches. But I think cities need to be inclusive if you want to have to play their role as integrators of people. And to create peaceful societies, otherwise you have just war territories, and to push, of course, for creativity as a tool for places. And of course, we have to create this very much for the designers, very much create human scale cities, and to push resilience and make public spaces really the area for this. The sustainability of urban identity. And then the policies, of course, is much, much bigger. But this is very super synthesis that I'm giving you. The entire book is about is an explosion of these 12 policies, pushing local sustainable development, creating links between cities and rural, because we don't think that there is a separation of territories and networks. Of course, trying to adapt urban governments to these challenges and finding sustainable financing processes. Now, so this is our book dreams, of course. I'm not saying that we have solved the issue, but I think we have advanced quite substantially the concept, the definition, the concept, the way in which heritage is interpreted, and the way in which heritage plays a role in sustainable urban development. And now, of course, it's it's a point of arrival of a long process, as you've seen, and certainly a point of departure. So we are now already entering the phase in which we're trying to look at the lessons learned, and we're trying to develop case studies. And a lot of people that are preparing case studies, and there are a number of new initiatives, both by UNESCO and other organizations, that are looking at ways in which how all these ideas can be can materialize and can become part of an